In the piece that I published on Friday, that was one of the points I made. When the data do call for removing some monetary accommodation, my preference would be that we first articulate a plan of exactly when and how we're going to roll off the balance sheet, and then we allow the markets to react to that plan, absorb that information, and then as we move forward, we allow the balance sheets to start running off, and then we can return to Fed fund rate hikes when the data call for it. So I'm in agreement. For my preference is we get going on the balance sheet next.
But let me ask, why aren't we in a position to start letting the balance sheet run down right now? Just because $4.5 trillion, I get it when we're in an emergency. It seems like we're a long way from an emergency at this point, though.
I agree, and I think that that's why all of us are looking at it very seriously now, and this is a point of comment or active discussion. And so I think we're going to do it at the right time. I'm pushing us to try to go sooner rather than later. But it is, if you think about it, the reason the Fed expanded the balance sheet back, you know, several years ago, once we hit zero, the question was, is the Fed out of ammunition? They bought longer dated bonds to push down the long end of the yield curve to encourage that kind of investment that Joe and I were talking about. That all made sense. Now, as the economy heals and it calls for removal of accommodation, I do think the balance sheet should be the next move.
The participation rate is all things to all people, too, Neil. I like your argument, because Leisman has been telling me for like years that it's got nothing to do with people wanting to work. It's all baby boomers retired, and it's demographics, and no, the 4-7 is real, and blah, blah, blah. And then, so then you use the opposite. You use it as evidence that there's plenty of slack left, and it's not really 4.7%. I don't know what to believe anymore. I mean, you're smart,
well,
Leisman's smart. Who's right?
Well, I'm right. He's wrong. I'm just teasing. We're both right. Here's the thing. If you look at the overall participation rate, Leisman's demographic factors absolutely show up, and the trend is gradually down because we're getting older as a society. So that's one way of looking at it. But what I prefer to look at is working-age adults. So you go a level deeper, and working-age adults, there's no good reason why that should be dropping. And yet it has dropped substantially because of the financial crisis.
People under 50, right? Like 30 to 50 that show up in and not participating in the workforce.
That's exactly right.
It doesn't feel like 4-7, that's for sure. And you'd have more wage growth.
Correct. So even now, wages have started to creep up, but they're not creeping up to a level that is concerning in terms of forward inflation. They're not back up to the levels they were at in growth in 05 and 06. So on core inflation, on inflation expectations, on wages, none of these are showing alarm signs right now. That tells me we've got room to wait to allow the labor market to continue to improve. And once the data shows that it's really time to remove accommodation, I'm going to be all for it.
For a guy that was there trying to deal with the housing bubble, that would be the other thing that people would bring up to you, that you don't know what low rates are really doing. You don't know where the next dislocation is going to be based on, you know, you're not seeing a lot of benefit from zero. And who knows if you're not, you might be inflating something somewhere that comes home to roost in the future. That's probably what they'd say to you. You must know there's nothing on the horizon then.
Well, no, it's a very fair question. And people point to the stock market's been booming. And my response to those folks is, We care about asset price movements if we think a correction could lead to financial instability or a financial crisis. And think about the tech bubble. The tech bubble burst. It was not good for the economy. Obviously, it hurt. But there was no risk of a financial collapse, not like the housing bubble. So the difference is the housing market has so much debt underneath it, it's much more dangerous if there's a correction. If equity markets drop, it's going to be painful for investors. But there's so little debt relative to housing. It doesn't look like it has a risk of leading to any kind of financial crisis. Our job is let the markets adjust.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.